Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. That just sums up what we just accomplished. So grateful for opportunities to worship with each other, and to just lift up the name of the Lord. Just so blessed to be a part of His family and to share with Him each and every day, and to invite our friends and our neighbors all to be a part of this same family to share with us. An elderly man was lying on his deathbed, and he turned to his wife and said, "Gladys, you know, you've always been with me. Through the good times, through the bad times, Gladys, you've been right here with me. Do you remember the time I lost my job, Gladys, and there you were right by my side? And you remember that time I fell off the roof? And you were right there to be with me, and you called the ambulance, and they came, and I recovered. You know, during the years of depression, Gladys, when we had pretty close to nothing, you're right there with me. And right now, here I am, lying at death's door, and you're right by my side, as always. You know what, Gladys? You're bad luck. You know, maybe this man failed to appreciate the love of the sacrifice of his wife's faithfulness, but, you know, we appreciate Gladys, don't we? She was doing everything she was supposed to do. Certainly want to welcome each of you here today, and so glad that you're sharing and worship with us, and certainly want to welcome our folks who are joining us on Facebook today, and glad you're with us. You know, there's many arenas of life we appreciate faithfulness. You know, when I set my DVR to record a program or a game, I like for it to be faithful. When I go home and turn it on, there it is. That's faithfulness. That's what I want to see happen. When I get a headache and I go to the cabinet for the bottle of Tylenol Extra Strength that has worked for me time and time again, I want that to continue to work for me, and faithfully it does. When I plug in my cell phone at night, I like to think when I get up in the next morning, it's going to be faithfully charging throughout the night, and when I open my phone in the morning, when my eyes can really focus, it says 100%. You know, that's the kind of thing I want. I want faithfulness in so many arenas of my life, and I appreciate it when I see it. But, you know, lack of faithfulness presents problems. Many marriages and homes are broken because someone chose to be unfaithful. Businesses fail because promises that are made and publicized are not kept. Friendships erode because trustworthiness becomes fractured. And sadly, it exists in Christ followers as well. One minister said, "If absence makes the heart grow fonder, a lot of folks must really love the church." You know, ministries constantly wonder if scheduled volunteers are actually going to show up that day. As Christ followers, we're commanded to be faithful. I love Proverbs 3:3 that says, "Let love and faithfulness never leave you. Bind them around your neck. Write them on the tablet of your heart." God is saying here that love and faithfulness are extremely important. And whatever it's going to take for you to remember that, to practice that regularly in your life, if you need to tie it around your neck, if you need somehow to write it across your heart, do it. Because it's too important not to do it. You know, when we accept Jesus as our Savior and are baptized, we receive the gift of the Holy Spirit, and God comes to live in us and provide for us supernatural help to be and to do things that we can't just do on our own. Certainly not consistently. We might have a good day, a good moment with something that we're trying to do on our own, but it doesn't last. It's been my experience, it's been yours. If it's not for God's help, These things are not going to be consistent in my life, and they are not going to grow. And the Spirit will help. The Holy Spirit will help you bear fruit as you grow and you mature in your relationship with God. And that's why we've been talking so much about this series, and certainly in this time where we're focusing on authentic relationship with Jesus and others. It is so important that we are locked into God and we are receiving the help from the resources that God has given us. And this fruit, when we yield to the Holy Spirit, when we're seeking to become like Jesus, is seen in character traits that we know as the fruit of the Spirit. There are 9 of them, and they're listed in Galatians 5. That verse, 2 verses says, "But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Against such things, there is no law." These things are always right. These things are always welcome. These are things that will always provide and yield good and holy things that honor the Father. They flow from the life that He has given us in Christ. Well, what exactly does faithfulness mean? Faithfulness means we follow through on commitments that we make. It's a commitment to being trustworthy, dependable, reliable. And it's important that we understand that it's not just responsibilities that we have, but faithfulness means we accept responsibilities because we are being faithful to a God who is doing His ministry in and through us. And so you can't just sit back and say, "Well, I'm not going to take on any responsibility, so I won't have to be faithful." Well, that's not being faithful to God, because God has given all of us talents and abilities, personalities, gifts, life experiences. And God is saying, these are the things, the special, unique person that you are, that I need to step up into my ministry and faithfully serve me. Ultimately, faithfulness points to being like God. I love the verse in Psalm 145, 13 that says, "The Lord is faithful to all His promises and loving toward all He has made." He is faithful to all of His promises. And He is consistently, unconditionally, unyielding in His love toward all that He's made. God always does what He says He will do. You can bank on it. You can rest your eternity upon it. You can rest your present and your past upon it. God is going to remain true all the way through. You know, every time we see a rainbow, it's a reminder that God is faithful to His promise. In Genesis 9:13, He said, "I have set my rainbow in the clouds, and it will be the sign of the covenant between me and the earth. Never again will the waters become a flood to destroy all life." And so when we see that beautiful rainbow in the sky, it always catches our attention. And we want to find a vantage point that we can see it better. And it's a reminder, not just because it's beautiful, but because it reminds us of God and He is faithful to keep His promises. Every time we take communion, we remember God's faithful promise in 1 John 1:9. If we confess our sins, He is faithful and just and will forgive us our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness. He is faithful to forgive us when we turn to Him for forgiveness, when we confess, when we repent. Every time we watch the seasons change, we're reminded of God's faithfulness. In Genesis 8:22, "As long as the earth endures, seed time and harvest, cold and heat, summer and winter, day and night, will never cease. Will never cease. When we watch the changing of seasons, we're reminded again that we have a faithful God and that He has created faithfulness into the order of creation, and we continue to watch that on a regular basis. And our God is faithful. And so we strive to be faithful because God is faithful. And the more we become like God, the more faithful we will be. And to help us better understand how to do this, we're going to look at Jesus, God in the flesh, to see and better understand what true faithfulness is all about. We know that faithfulness is following through with a commitment regardless of the difficulty. Faithfulness cost Jesus His life, but He remained faithful. He is our example, our model of faithfulness. And so we look to Him to learn from Him. As we strive to become more like Him, we become, obviously, more like God. We're going to be looking at 2 points today. The outline's on the back of your bulletin. The points will be on the screen. If you have YouVersion, and you've turned to that, and you have gone to more, and you have found us in advance, you can click on that, and you can see all the sermon points, all the scriptures. You can add your own notes. It's entirely up to you. And if you all need help setting that up, some of you that have smartphones, please always grab one of us in the back following the service or any time. Be more than glad to help you get that set up. The first point is that faithfulness is an expected fruit of becoming like Jesus. It's an expected fruit of becoming like Jesus. So what did we see in Jesus' life? Where was faithfulness displayed? Well, first of all, Jesus faithfully gathered with others to worship. In Luke 4:16, we read He went to Nazareth where He had been brought up, and on the Sabbath day He went into the synagogue as was His custom. Jesus went to the synagogue, the Jewish place of worship and prayer and learning, as was His custom. Apparently, He was in the habit of gathering with other believers on a weekly basis. And apparently, this was obviously not the only time that He connected with God. It may not have even been His favorite time of connecting with God. You know, he did so personally. He did so in smaller groups. He did so in a large group setting, as we're looking at here. But He was faithful to it because He knew it was important. You know, many people see attending worship services as something to be endured, or a weekly thing that you can check off your list and say, okay, got that out of the way. I love what Tony Evans, a minister in Dallas, said that when he was a teenager, he said he had a drug problem. Every week his parents drug him to church services. You know, the Bible reminds us in Hebrews chapter 10, verse 25, and let us not neglect our meeting together as some people do, but encourage one another, especially now that the day of His return is drawing near. We continually, faithfully meeting together because Jesus said it was important, but also because of what says here in Hebrews 10:25. Your regularity and consistency in worship is encouraging to other people. It's encouraging to other people to know that you're here, to know that you have made this important, to know that you have done what you need to do to be here when you can. Sometimes we can't be, but when you can be, it encourages your other believers, your other brothers and sisters in Christ, but it also influences our perspective, because we're reminded when we meet together that God is over all, that He is sovereign. And one day, regardless of what the world happens in the world and the craziness that's going on in the world today, one day Jesus is coming back. And some of us may still be living, and if so, we're going to go be with Him forever. But whenever that happens to be, and none of us know, nobody knows when that's going to be, But we're reminded that one day we're going to be with Him in heaven. That this isn't the last stop in life's journey. There's more beyond this. And certainly there is out there for us an eternity in heaven that's beyond our ability to describe. But when we gather together, we're reminded of life's perspective. Life is moving forward. Some terrible things are happening, but some really good things are happening. And someday there's an eternity with the Lord, and we want to be ready for that. And if He happens to come today or tomorrow or next week, hallelujah. This journey will be over. The trials and difficulties of this life will be over. But we're faithfully remembered in that when we gather together. You know, certainly the church is not the most important thing in life, but Jesus is. Jesus is. And when we allow our faithfulness in the church to decline, it is almost impossible for our faithfulness to Christ not to be affected. The body, His body is the church. He is the head of the body. And you cannot separate the two and not have both affected. Jesus modeled faithfulness to a large group gathering for worship, and we need the same. But we also notice that Jesus was faithful in prayer. He spent personal time in prayer. Luke 5:16, but Jesus often withdrew to lonely places and prayed. You know, if the Lord of the universe needed prayer to sustain Him in the daily challenges of His life, we certainly need it as well, don't we? And why do we tend to ignore our need for the same help? Why do we think personal time with God was fine with Jesus, but it's not really necessary for us? Where did we get that line of thinking? It's not following the model of Jesus. Personal time with God is so critically important in our relationship with Him. One of the things that we launched on Easter was some one-on-one with people that are just struggling in this area. You know, they're battling with that daily time. Or maybe they've never had one and they're not really sure what to do and how to set that up and how to make that significant. And other people, they've just struggled with consistency. Do it a while, stop it a while. Do it a while, stop it a while. And they feel so bad about that they can't maintain this. If that's you, that's where that box is on the Connect card where you can check that you would like someone to talk to you about that. And we'll get those cards during the week. We will contact you. And we'll set up a time. We'll just sit down and talk about that with you. We'll give you some things to help you get started or to help you be stronger in that area of your life. Because this is so critically important. Why live a life feeling guilty that you're not doing what you should? Do something about it. And this is a great opportunity. We'd love to help you. We'd love to help you. It's too important not to. Colossians 4:2 says, devote yourselves to prayer, being watchful and thankful. Devote yourselves to prayer. This is what Jesus needed and did. We need it even more than He. But we also know that Jesus faithfully maintained healthy relationships. In John 15:15-16, He said, I have called you friends, for everything that I have learned from my Father I have made known to you. You did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you to go and bear fruit, fruit that will last. Jesus called His disciples friends. Friends. He had a relationship with them. It was a close relationship with them. Certainly there were times that He had to reprimand them, but Jesus loved His disciples deeply. He always kept their best interest in mind. He celebrated their accomplishments. He rejoiced with their victories. Jesus served His own disciples out of His deep love and affection for them. Jesus understood the importance of being faithful and having healthy relationships. And faithfulness is vital to strong and healthy relationships with others. This is why part of our vision statement talks about that, that we're striving for authentic relationships with Jesus and others. Because the closer we grow to God, the more we have to offer to other people, the more other people become important to us, and the better those relationships become. What kind of friend are you, really, to other people? Are you the one always asking for help? Or do you offer help as well? Are you quick to point out a friend's mistake? Or do you offer eagerly an encouraging word to them? Do you join in the latest gossip, or do you speak up for your friend? What kind of friend are you? Are relationships important to you? Are you investing in them? We know that Jesus faithfully as well, not only in healthy relationships, but faithfully stood in the truth. 78 times in the New Testament, Jesus said, "I tell you the truth." Jesus told the truth. He taught the truth. He lived the truth. He said, "I am the truth." For us to be faithful in the truth means living like Jesus did. Being faithful in the truth like Jesus was. And that means being honest in what we say. It means doing what we say we are going to do. Faithful Christians don't just tell the truth, they live the truth. Faithful Christ followers fulfill their responsibilities in the church. Faithful Christ followers pay their bills. Faithful Christ followers remain generous to God even when times get tough. Jesus faithfully stood in the truth, but Jesus faithfully obeyed God as well. In Luke chapter 22, verse 39, the night before Jesus was crucified, we read these words, "And accompanied by the disciples, Jesus left the upstairs room and went as usual to the Mount of Olives. And there he told them, 'Pray that you will not give in to temptation.' He walked away about a stone's throw and knelt down and prayed, 'Father, if you are willing, please take this cup of suffering away from me. Yet I want your will to be done, not mine.'" Jesus came to this garden for a final time of prayer before the suffering that would lead to his death. And this was an intense time of struggle for him. You see, Jesus dreaded the cross. He was human enough to look at that and know what happens on the cross. He knew what crucifixion was. He knew how horrible his death was going to be. But Jesus dreaded the cross not because he was afraid to die, but because his death would involve the bearing of sin and the guilt of the whole world. We can't even comprehend the weight of that. But here's Jesus. "Father, if you are willing, if there's any other way, please take this cup of suffering away from me. Yet not as I will. I want your will to be done, not mine." You know, Jesus longed to be home with his Father, safe in his Father's arms, once again recognized as a Lord of heaven and earth, which he was and is. But Jesus also knew that he had a job to do. He had a world to save that was not going to be saved any other way. And he was faithful to his mission. He was committed to you and to me and anyone else that would hear the sound of his voice. You know, you and I are never going to be asked to die for the sins of the world. But we are expected to obey God in everything. as our core value state with no conditions and no reservations, regardless of consequences. That is the commitment. That is the faithfulness to commitment that the Scriptures call us to. That is what we see in the life and the death of Jesus. Faithfulness to death, if that is what is required. But faithfulness certainly to live for Jesus. Jesus Christ is the Lord of our lives. Living for Him is a 24/7 commitment. We are faithful to Him despite the pressure to cave in to the influence of our culture. But in faith, we obey Him, ever asking the Holy Spirit to help us. Ever asking the Holy Spirit to help us. Because sometimes it's hard. The second point, faithfulness has its own challenges and rewards. Its own challenges and rewards. Some human challenges include these. We get tired. We get tired. Bob Hope once said, "Today my heart beat 103,369 times. My blood traveled 168 million miles. I breathed 23,400 times. I ate 3 pounds of food. I generated 450 tons of energy. I spoke 4,800 words. I moved 750 major muscles. And I exercised 7 million brain cells. Gee, I'm tired." Don't we get tired sometimes? We do so many things. We carry so much responsibility. And energy can ebb pretty low. But even though we acknowledge that and just know that's part of our humanness, there is no excuse to stop being faithful to God. It doesn't matter how tired we are. It's no excuse not to obey God. Another human challenge we face is we deal with fear. We live with the fear of failure. What if I try and I fail and I have to live with that? Will others see me as a failure? Why invite more rejection into my life? My self-esteem is low enough already. There are others better suited for this task than me. Some of you have played those tapes in your brain. Moses played those tapes in his brain. And they've been in a lot of our minds as well. And so we deal with fear. And we ask God to help us in the midst of fear. And He will. But another thing we struggle with is we seldom see immediate results. You know, some things you do, you mow the yard, you paint the house. I mean, you see immediate change. I mean, it's just right in front of you. Boom, it's changed. The grass is shorter, the walls a different color. I mean, it's immediate. And it's kind of its own personal reward if it looks good. But we see immediate results, and we like things that have immediate or pretty close results to when we finish a job. But you know, a lot of things in obedience to God are not in that category. They're not like instant change. You know, you're talking to a group of people in a class or in a service like this, and you're wondering, how much are they taking in? Yeah. And it's growth, it's slow, and things are happening in your brain, and in the classes and in different places and settings we are, you start talking to a friend about Christ and you see not immediate result. And you're sitting there thinking, was that a waste of time or did they absorb that? I mean, I couldn't see any connection with this person while I was sharing my story with them. So many things in the Christian life where they're just not immediate results. And sometimes we get frustrated with that. The late George Mueller prayed for 5 of his friends that they would receive Jesus as their Lord and Savior. 5 of his friends he knew were not saved, and so George Mueller began praying for them. After many months, one of them came to the Lord. One. Many months of praying. But George Mueller kept praying. It was 10 years later, the two others were converted. George Mueller keeps praying. 10 years later, two more. There's three. It took 25 years before the fourth man was saved. And Mueller continued praying for 52 years until his own death. 52 years he prayed for this fifth man, and then George Mueller died. But shortly after Mueller's funeral, the fifth friend came to Jesus. But George Mueller never stopped praying. There weren't immediate results to his prayers. He couldn't see what was going on in the lives of these men as he continued to share with them. But probably most of it was George Mueller's prayers. And he just never gave up. And all five of them eventually came to Christ. And hallelujah for that. But a lot of times, many things we do for the Lord just aren't immediate results. It was Vance Havner, a preacher, that said most of us would live by faith if we knew that the rewards would be forthcoming inside of 2 weeks. You know, if it would just all happen within 2 weeks, I mean, our faith could be really strong, you know, is what we'd tell ourselves. But there's no timetables. God knows what they are. We're just called to be faithful. But you know, the rewards for faithfulness are worth it all. I don't think there's any greater feeling than knowing that you're doing what God wants you to do. There is nothing more fulfilling and satisfying than knowing you're right where God wants you to be, doing what God wants you to do. And that's why we want all of you to find that place, if you haven't found it already. Because it's so important, it's so satisfying, it is nurturing to your soul. And you feel that sense of purpose being lived out through you in the way that God made you and wants you to serve. And you continue to grow in it. And it's a great, great feeling. But you know, it's so great to know what's in your future as a faithful servant as well. Because faithfulness, the Bible says, brings God's praise and blessing. You remember the parable of the talents when Jesus told the master who gave amounts of money to three of his servants to use while he was away. And when the master returned, two of the servants had done just that. They have invested what he had given them. They had doubled the amount that they'd received. And the master was very, very pleased. And they both heard these words. The master said, "Well done, my good and faithful servant. You have been faithful in handling this small amount. So now I will give you many more responsibilities. Let's celebrate together." And it's going to be great to hear God say, "Well done, you good and faithful servant. Come, let's celebrate together for eternity." It'll be great to hear God say those words to you. Because in heaven, the celebration never ends. You have an eternity of feeling fulfilled, satisfied. You've done what you're called to do, and God is pleased with you. Let's pray. Father, thank you so much for calling us to live in your Spirit and to bear the fruit of that relationship. That you are a living God and your Spirit is living within us, seeking to help us to see as you see, feel as you feel, strength to overcome temptation, strength to win victories for you, strength to stand when we feel like we have no energy, strength to be faithful, as long as we are drawing breath. And so, Father, we pray to be those kind of people, and we can't do it on our own. We need you. We need your Spirit. We just continue to pray that we would put ourselves in connection to you, the true vine of life, as we as branches connected into you, and that we will bear fruit that shows the world that we belong to you. But it's a welcoming family. hearts are open to those who would seek Jesus as their own personal Lord and Savior, to want those things that you have given to us, that living relationship that just affects everything else about life. We pray that that is what is seen in us and becomes our greater reality. We pray these things in Jesus' name. I read this week of a statement someone had made. I've thought about it a lot of the week. We are judged by what we finish, not by what we start. We are judged by what we finish, not what we start. And that is a statement about faithfulness. But as I thought more about this statement, I realized you also had to emphasize it's important to start. Because so many things are just never started. They're talked about. They're said, that's a good thing. Let's do that. But the start never comes. It doesn't matter what arena it's in. If something's not started, there's not going to be a finish. There's not going to be a time when you're strong to the very end and you complete the task. You first have to start. And this morning, maybe that's what you're called to, is a new start. And it's kind of redundant. A fresh start. Never accepted Jesus as your Lord and Savior. You're looking for that living relationship with the only one that can save you of your sin and bring that peace within that you have never had. Maybe you're looking for a church family, a group of people that aren't sitting in judgment of you, but they're loving you, they're helping you, they're encouraging you, they're serving alongside of you. They are on a journey with you through everything that life throws at you. Your best friends, your greatest supporters are going to become your church family. God called us to be. And today I'd love to talk to you about the church, a personal relationship with Jesus, because they were so important to Him. But today maybe you just need someone to pray with you, and we're happy to do that. Just ask as we sing if you move to one of us with the badges on. We'll be more than happy to step aside and pray with you today. What's the burden you're carrying that you don't need to carry alone? Someone share it with you today. Just ask that you'd stand with us now as we sing. If you're called to make some decision, have a conversation with someone today, open up about a prayer need, do that today as we worship together. You can be seated. We celebrated on Thursday night our preschool graduation, and this room was alive on Thursday night. It is today, but not like when you got that many little ones in the room. But a lot of excited parents, a lot of excited kids, and a culmination of a great year with our preschool. And I just appreciate Christy, who served as our director for the past 18 years. Is that the term I'm here? Wow, we. And yes, indeed. And those four-year-olds that graduated, and they were so cute in their little gowns. I just love watching parents celebrate that, and family members, and our three-year-old class is getting their certificates. And it was a great day for the staff, for Christy. And, of course, Christy was honored at the end of that because she is stepping down, or has stepped down as our director after all this time. And so we want today to celebrate Christy's contribution to the ministry of our church, certainly through our preschool and many other ways, but this specifically today. So she wanted to say a few words today to you, and we'll move on from there. So you got a few things. You need to sit this down.
I won't be long. I promise. It's really not that big. So 18 years ago. I was approached to teach preschool, and I had no clue what I was getting myself into. The first year I taught, I got locked out of my classroom. I got hit. I had a little girl that was laying on the floor. I couldn't ever do anything with her. And I was like, God, I'm just not really sure about this. But I just kept praying, and just like Randy said, God's faithfulness. 18 years later, I look back, and it was the most rewarding thing, next to being a mom, of course, but it was the most rewarding thing that I've ever done, and I just give all the glory to God, because I couldn't have gotten through the last 18 years without Him. He got me through a lot of difficult situations and helped me learn a lot about myself 18 years, so I just give him just all the glory and honor, because preschool would not be what it is today without him. So I also just want to thank the preschool board, Kathy Anderson, Betty Lyons, Rhonda Beard, Dudley Spencer, Evan Hardwick. I'm probably forgetting somebody. I know I probably am. Charlotte Willoughby. They have been such a great support to me, encouraging me, and just having my back, and being a godly example of what, how you should handle difficult situations. And I just looked up to them so much, and I just can't thank them enough for giving me the opportunity to be in the position that I am and or was. And so I thank them for their encouragement and support. I just want to thank the teachers, Julie Baskin, Cindy Brady, and Linda Reeves. I don't see her, but they've been a huge support to me as well. And they've done so much, gone above and beyond, and just went along with all my crazy ideas and loved me. And there's just not many places you can go to work and pray before you start your day. And that was just always been such an encouraging thing to me. So I love you guys, and you're going to do great, Julie. I also just want to thank the church family just for their support throughout the years. I know you've done a lot of donations, a lot of prayers. You've welcomed people into this building, and I just thank you guys for just the encouragement you've been to me as well. So I want to thank, I promise I'm not going to be long, Adam, who I've always joked that I'm a thorn in his side for. I always wanted to put the risers up and something with the sound or something. So thank you so much. And Vanessa, who always does our programs. So thank you. And last but not least, I want to thank my family, my mom, my Ashley and Connor, and of course my husband, Craig. Their support is like none other. There has been times, especially during certain times of the year, where we didn't know if laundry was going to get done, or if they were going to have food on the table, or if mom was going to be in a grouchy mood or what. But just their love and support has just meant so much to me, and I love you so much. So I think that's all. Julie Baskins has taken over my role. She has a heart for God and a heart for children, and I know she is going to do great things. So I'm praying for you, and I will be here for you. So thank you so much to everybody.
Thanks, Cook. Look at all the thanks we're giving.
We certainly, she mentioned Julie taking over as director, Julie Baskin, so we're really excited about that. And Melanie Blair will be taking Julie's teaching spot, and so we're very excited about additions to our preschool. It'll be a strong program moving forward, has for a long, long time, and we just trust that that will continue to be. And thanks for the partnership that we share with this ministry, and we ever look forward to it. We're going to be having a reception at the back following the service. If you'd like a chance to speak to Christy personally today, you can do so. But there is some refreshments back there for you as we depart. I'm going to pray and dismiss our service, and then we'll be moving to the reception area. So pray with me. Father, we're so grateful for your faithfulness to us. And when we can look and see that, it just warms our hearts and encourages us, especially to know that you are a God who will continue to be so. And so we thank you, Father, when we see faithfulness in others, when we see it in people who just carry on in their faith and physical challenges and family challenges and different things that go on. When we celebrate someone today that has served so faithfully in our preschool as a teacher and director, and as Christy has done, and Father, we're just so grateful for that work. The faithfulness of that, and we give you thanks for her life and her ministry and her time here. We certainly pray and continue to pray for our preschool and those who continue to serve there, for so many other faithful volunteers who serve every week and so many ministries. We just give you thanks for everyone. We cannot be what we are without without the faithful work of our volunteers, and you know who they are, Father, and I just love them and are grateful for each of their lives. And so today we just want to give you thanks for who you are. We want to lift you up, and Father, we just want to thank you for this time of celebration, and Father, just a time of just knowing changes have come, and Father, we just want to rally and meet those, and just to carry on in a strong way for you, because lives are important, people matter, little children matter, their families matter, they matter to you, they matter to us, and we just want to continue to minister to them faithfully, and hopefully we can plant seeds, build bridges, and lead them to you if that's something they need in their lives. But thank you, Father, for the food that's here. Thank you for the warmth of the gathering this morning. We just give you praise as we go forth to serve. In the name of Jesus, we pray.